this.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
This.
Oh, do it.
That would be
hell.
I found a few items, and I just want to get you guys' opinion on some things that I found.
Good.
This is awesome right here. Are you guys ready for this?
It's
if you start a question with, can I steal, the answer is always no.
Sorry.
Whoever said that.
Hey,
I'm
sorry.
The answer is always no.
Sorry, that was me.
Okay, look at this.
Oh, cool.
What?
Can I borrow this?
You know where I found this?
In your glove.
Oh,
in
your
in the Life Church attic. I didn't know that we have the connectors to make this thing work anymore, but I just wanted you guys to see some random things I found. Let me help me out here. I've got some glow-in-the-dark spray paint, which I'm going to find a use for soon. I'm going to spray some stuff out and make it glow-in-the-dark. I have an old camcorder that has a really huge lens that says TV zoom lens.
Very nice.
So I feel like we should record some stuff for TV with that, but I don't know. And I've got this sledgehammer, right? 12-pound sledge. I can destroy a lot of things with this sucker.
Can I steal that?
No, you cannot steal this. Help me out with some answering some questions. Which one of these three items would help me to scramble eggs in the morning?
The sledgehammer.
Maybe that's about the closest one. Which one of these ladies would help you with your eyeliner application in the morning? The camera with no screen? It doesn't even have a viewfinder.
You can look in the, like,
there, this end?
Wait, is the sledgehammer shiny?
No, it's not shiny. Which one, Brendan, would help you to ride your skateboard?
Bro, the camera. You
could
record your
trip. The glow-in-the-dark stuff would help you to ride your skateboard. Grace, which one would help you play your guitar? None of them. Fred is the correct answer. None of them would help you. Now, everyone that sent a text message, LCEUs, to 95577, would any of these help you send your text message?
Yes.
Sledgehammer.
If your phone is like mine and you want to smash it with a sledgehammer, that would be the case. But none of these items would help you accomplish any of these tasks because they were all created with a different purpose. And as you saw in our promo video, we're starting a new series tonight called Foundations, and I hope that it will help you to see the purpose that God has for your life.
Did you make that?
All right. Huh?
Did you make that?
I did.
Why did it say iMovie?
Because I made it in iMovie. Yeah. So tonight I'm going to give you a little background. We're going to be talking, we're going to be looking at the first part of the book of Romans. So little JBQ quiz here. Who wrote Romans?
Roman.
No.
David.
No.
Caesar.
Paul. The Apostle Paul wrote the book of Romans. Now, who did he write to? This is a letter written by Paul to whom?
Caesar.
The Romans. Yes. More specifically, the church in Rome. Where is Rome?
Caesar.
No.
Wow. Egypt.
No.
British.
Shaped like a boot.
British.
Louisiana.
No. Not Louisiana.
Italy.
What?
Italy.
Italy. Thank you, Brooke. Give Brooke a hand. Yes. I didn't hear it. I heard Brooke finally say it. So let me give you a little bit of background into this church that Paul is writing this letter to. This is a time in history when the Roman power was the superpower in the world. In fact, Italy was a central area, but Rome specifically was the city that everything pointed back to. It was the capital of the empire, so everybody that was important, all the people that were in power lived in and around Rome. It was a central place of activity for the entire known world, and people from all over the world would send ambassadors to Rome with offerings, with peace offerings, and they would want to make sure that they were on good relations with Roman leaders. And there's an old saying that says, all roads lead to Rome.
Yeah.
Well, that was in essence a case. The Roman highway system started at the city of Rome and branched out all over the world, even up into what is now England, Great Britain. There were not roads across the water. Don't think that there was a huge bridge at one point. There wasn't a tunnel at that point. But the Romans built roads everywhere, and many of them are still in existence today. But it was a very important place. But the problem is that this city, Rome, was a lot like we are today. The rich were very rich, and the poor were very poor. The rich would do whatever they want. They had huge parties. They had whatever food or drink they could imagine. They did whatever they want, even very depraved things that were twisted and perverted. The rich Romans felt like they could do whatever they want, and they did it. And the poor barely got by. There were selfish people in the society. There were political alliances that people would give favors or gifts to people that were in power, and they would in turn get a favor back in the way that they wanted. And so, does that sound like any place today that you know of?
America.
Sounds a lot like America, right?
America.
I should have worn my Stars and Stripes kit.
Yeah, you should.
I should have, dang it. They didn't match my outfit. But Paul is writing this letter to a time when the culture was very dark. And he's writing to a church, and so this church was called to be a light in the darkness. Now, this is a lot like us today. We live in a dark society, and that sin is accepted, and people think they can do whatever they want, and it's fine, and we're called to be a light. So I think that we can learn a lot if we will pay attention to what Paul says in Romans 1. So if you have your Bible or your Bible app, turn to Romans chapter 1 and verse 1. We're going to read pretty quickly through the first 17 verses. If you didn't have your Bible, it's in little print on your handout, and it'll also be on the screen in a little bit bigger print. I'm going to move my sweet camcorder and my can of spray paint out of the way. Write this first thing down. One, the first thing we see here is the introduction. The introduction. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 1, it says this: "From Paul, a slave of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. This gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his son who was a descendant of David with reference to the flesh, who was appointed the Son of God in power according to the Holy Spirit by the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him we have received grace and our apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles on behalf of his name." Verse 6, "You also are among them called to belong to Jesus." So in this first part of this letter, Paul introduces himself. He introduces, he talks about who he is. He's called to be an apostle. He considers himself a slave of Jesus. And then he talks about who Jesus is, the Son of God. He was a descendant of David by his fleshly parents, but he is the Son of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. He was crucified. He died, but he was resurrected through the power of God. And then he gives this introduction to, as an apostle, what we're called to do, and that's to help people come to obedience in the faith. And so, after that introduction, write the second thing down: the audience. In verses 7 to 15, Paul describes the audience, which is who again? The Romans, the church in Rome, right? And this is what he says: "To all those loved by God in Rome," right? So it's not just one house church. He's talking to everybody that calls himself a believer in the city of Rome. He wants them to hear this letter. "Called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First of all, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed throughout the whole world. For God, whom I serve in my spirit by preaching the gospel of his Son, is my witness that I continually remember you, and I always ask in my prayers if perhaps now at last I may succeed in visiting you according to the will of God." Verse 11. "For I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you. That is, that we may be mutually comforted by one another's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I often intended to come to you and was prevented until now, so that I might have some fruit even among you, just as I already have among the rest of the Gentiles. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and the foolish. Thus, I am eager also to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome." So we see that Paul's writing, and he's telling us about his audience, and this section of verses describes just how much Paul loves these believers, right? He has great affection for them. He wants the peace of God to be upon them. He thinks about them often as he prays for them. He knows that their reputation is great and that he always wanted to visit them. But this also tells us that was Paul the one that planted the church in Rome? Fred? Okay. No. How do we know that? He hadn't been there. Right? How would he have planted a church where he hadn't gone yet, right? So, did he establish that church? No. Right? Because he hadn't been there. He hadn't gone there yet. This is a church that Paul had never been to. He'd never met these people face to face. He'd never interacted with them. He only knows them by their reputation. That's important. We're going to come back to that in a few minutes. And we read in the last couple verses of this passage that we're reading tonight, write this down, number 3, the purpose. So we were introduced to Paul and Jesus in the introduction. The second part, we learned about the audience that Paul is writing to the church in Rome that he has great care and concern for. And he remembers them, he prays for them, he wants to come and visit with them so that he can give them the knowledge of God. And then he comes to the purpose of this entire letter. Now this is how important this purpose is. These next two verses describe what Paul is going to spend 15 and a half chapters building upon. Right? In the first 15 verses of the entire book of Romans, it's just the introduction of Paul, Jesus, and his audience. Verses 16 and 17 give the entire purpose for the entire rest of the book that he gives. Listen to this. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is God's power for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For the righteousness of God is revealed in the gospel from faith to faith, just as it is written, the righteous by faith will live. Here's the purpose. I want you to write this down. This is your fill-in. And we're going to spend the rest of our time tonight talking about, breaking down what this means. Be about what you were called out to live out. I know. Be about what you were called out to live out. You need to write that down. You can take a picture and make the background on your phone. You can take a Sharpie and write it on your arm, because that is the whole purpose of the book of Romans. Be about what you were called out to live out. Now we're going to kind of break this down. Be about. What are we called to be about? Paul gives us some clear direction that we are supposed to be about the gospel. Well, what is the gospel? The gospel is a word that we get in our English language from a German word which means gut spiel, which means good news. You guys know that?
Yes.
That's where we get the word gospel, is from gut spiel. Did I say it right, Mr. German? Gut spiel. Right? So that's where we get the good news. Well, what is the good news? The good news is I was lost, but now I'm found. I was dying as a sinner, but Jesus, by his grace, saved me. And so Paul says that's what we're supposed to be about. And then those verses, he says the gospel is God's power for salvation to everyone who believes. And that's something that Paul's not ashamed about. In the first, in verse 5, the second part of verse 5, he says this, we are called to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles on behalf of Jesus' name. So Paul's pretty clear that we're supposed to be about the gospel. He says that we are like him, an apostle. That we are to go out and teach other people about Jesus. And we're not supposed to be the people that go and smack people around, like with your Bible, you just get it and beat them up and try and shove it down their throat and try and force Christianity upon them. That's not the method of Jesus. Jesus' method is love. Right? We are supposed to love God first and foremost. Right, Jaden?
Yes.
I need you to move over 2 seats. Because I think Joey's preaching a message that you are listening to. Joey already did it. Good job. I didn't have to come to you next. So, we are supposed to preach the gospel. We're supposed to love people. And our love for God and our love for others is supposed to be a gospel message. And then, when we have opportunity, we use our words. So what do we use first? Through. Love through God through what we do. through our actions, right? We love with actions, and when we have opportunity, we use words to tell people why we love them so much, right? Because God loved us. So that's what we're supposed to be about, the good news, the gospel. And he says you should be about what you were, number two, called out, right? Look again at Romans 1:1. For Paul, a slave of Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. What was Paul called to be? An apostle. Anybody know what that word means? Fred?
Somebody sent by God.
Yes! Give Fred a hand. He nailed it. Somebody sent by God. That was a really weak hand. Everybody give Fred a hand. An apostle is one who is set apart and sent. Now, some people kind of get really up on themselves and be like, well, my name is Apostle T.R. Stewart of the Life Church of God of Christ in Emporia, and I don't think I need a title. I'm just supposed to be it. Now, Paul was an apostle in that there's different terms, different kinds of apostles. And in the Bible, we see some apostles were people that had actually seen Jesus. Paul was one of those because he saw the resurrected Jesus in a vision, and he was transformed forever. Right, but we are a different kind of apostle in that God has called us and set us apart to reach the people in our circle of influence. Some apostles are called and sent out, and they are sent to other areas, other nations, other cities, other cultures. And you might be one of those one day, but right now, I don't think you can like emancipate yourself from your parents and just like go on the road. Can you? I don't think you can in Kansas. I think maybe in Missouri some of you could. But is it in Kansas? Yeah. So, here's the thing. Paul said he's an apostle set apart to be a witness, and we too are called to be apostles. We're supposed to be used by God to share his love and the good news of Jesus with other people. And I need you to understand this. Long before you were born, before your mom met your dad, long before your grandma met your grandpa, and even before Adam first laid his eyes on Eve, and even before God had that moment where he said, let there be light, God had a plan and a purpose for your life. For every one of our lives, he called us to something big. We're supposed to fulfill this plan that God had laid out even before time began. And ultimately, the basic call of every person is to spread the gospel and to make disciples. We're called to very simply make Jesus known. To make Jesus famous. Be about what you were called out. The third thing that statement says is, be about what you're called out to live out. Earlier, I took all these mix-matched items, and one of them is this awesome glow-in-the-dark spray paint. I don't know why. I have a problem. I really like glow-in-the-dark paint.
Amazing.
It is amazing. I painted that sign with glow-in-the-dark paint. Can you hit the UVs for me, Taylor? I think it's seven. This is why, no, not that one, eight. Sorry, seven is that one. Yeah, there we go. Now I got some UV. So you can see, these lights are killing it, aren't they? And you can see right here, in fact, that I am glowing, right? Because I've got, there we go. Now you can see my glowy sign. So if we started spraying this paint all over the place, it would do a really good job of making things glow, right? But if I went over here and I had to clean this window because Hope was waiting for her mom and dad or her sister to show up and she was just sitting there like leaning against the glass. Not that you would do this, Hope. I'm just saying if you decided just leaning against the glass and I was like, oh, I got to get the handprints and face print off the glass. Would this make a very good glass cleaner?
Yes.
Like, Gracie, if I decided to like just wash your headband and your hair, would it? It wouldn't do a very good job, right? Because that's not the purpose of this paint, is it? If I really wanted to have this paint be its purpose, I would need to find some wood that I wanted to make glow, and I would spray paint it, and then I would turn my UV lights, and I'd come in here and just stare at it, because I like glow in the dark paint. But if I needed a pillow, I wouldn't choose to snuggle up with my sledgehammer.
I would.
Because it doesn't make a very good pillow. But if someone called me and they bought a house and they said, hey, it's demo day, guess what? I'm going to go get the sledgehammer. I'm going to chart my way over to their house because it's demo day, baby. I love demo day. And this sledgehammer is a great demo day tool because I can smash things, right? It's good for breaking tubs. Not that I know. I mean, I do from personal experience. But it's not good for a pillow, right? It does not have a good reputation of something that is soft and snuggly. No, it doesn't. It doesn't. You can come up here later and you can snuggle with it, I guess, but that's not the reputation. This has a reputation for hurting people's toes because they don't know how to use it and they don't have proper foot care and they go and they smash something and they overswing and wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, there goes my foot, right? That is how that goes. That's the reputation of the sledgehammer. I know, it'd be fine. So, here's the thing. We know things have a good reputation by what people say about them, right? If I'm looking for a company to help me fix something, I might go on Facebook on one of the buy-sell trades and say, hey, who knows a good plumber because I need some pipes fixed. And people would say, hey, use Spelman Plumbing because they've always treated me right. Or they would say, no, don't use Spelman Plumbing because they're horrible and they did horrible work and they overcharged me. Whatever their reputation is, people say it by what they say about it, right? That's why we read reviews online of products before we buy them. Well, each and every one of you has a reputation. People might not know you at school. They haven't haven't talked to you. But there's probably a good chance, Emporia is not that big, that there's a good chance that a lot of people know who you are by your reputation, right? Now, that could be really good. That could be really bad. That might be just kind of middle of the road. I don't know where you fall, but here's the thing. Even though our reputation precedes us, we have a chance to start new and make our reputation about Jesus. Even if we have a bad reputation, we can turn it around. Paul said this about the church in Rome in verse 8. He said, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed throughout the whole world. Remember how I said Rome was the center of civilization at this time? All roads led to Rome. And Paul's saying that everywhere that he traveled in the known world, the reputation of the Roman Christians was preceding them everywhere they went. And he was excited to go and meet them. So what does that say about us? We're called to live out our faith, to be faithful, to have the kind of life that leads to a good reputation. People need to think about us as individuals who are in churches that love God and love people. I don't want the reputation of like the people from Westboro Baptist, because their reputation is they hate people. Their reputation is they picket funerals. Their reputation is that they go and they hold up signs and they protest. Does that really tell anybody about Jesus' love?
No.
I want the reputation of Life Church, where when it's warm on Saturday night, you're likely to find a prayer tent downtown where there's people just hanging out, willing to pray with somebody and tell them about Jesus' love. I'm going to be a part of Life Church that on Halloween, instead of saying Halloween is bad, we fill our parking lot and give people candy and take free pictures of them because we want them to see in a way that they can feel the love of Jesus. I want to be a part of Life Church that when we find out somebody is sick, we might take them a meal because we've got people that are invested in a meal train. Or I want to be part of Life Church that has a group of ladies that really like to sew, and they make little cute baby newborn hats and they deliver them to the single moms that are at the women's shelter. That's showing people love. And that's building a reputation of people that love God and love people. And I know there's a ton of other churches in Emporia that are doing great things. I don't want you to think that I think the whole body of Christ is here, but I really love our church and I love that we are about loving God and loving people. And that's what Paul says we should all be about. That should be our reputation. We can begin making a change in our lives. And when we begin making that change to follow Jesus, people will know. The word will get out. And people will begin to hear about your new reputation. You guys know what Paul's reputation was? Paul was known as a guy that hated Christians. Paul was known as a guy that dragged Christians off to jail by their hair. Paul was a guy that was known for going and taking Christians and beating them and throwing them behind bars. But then he met Jesus, and his reputation changed. And Paul went from being that guy to being the guy that was willing to get beat up and have stones thrown at him and dragged out of the city and left for dead for Jesus. You guys know how Paul eventually made his way to Rome? No, in chains. He was a prisoner. When Paul finally made it to Rome, his introduction there was not that a church invited him and sent the best chariot to go find him and bring him in, and they put him up in the best inn in all of Rome. Paul finally made his visit to Rome and met the Roman Christians and met people in Caesar's household because he was a prisoner because of Jesus. They arrested him for preaching Jesus. That's how drastically his reputation changed. See, if you begin making a change in your life, the word will get out. People will begin to hear about your new reputation that's driven by your new faith. Tomorrow's a brand new opportunity to start brand new in your reputation as you live for Jesus. So you want people to talk about how much you love God and love people. You don't want them to talk about the fact that you might have been a cheater or a gossip or rude or hateful or disrespectful to your parents and teachers. That's not the reputation you want. Don't let those things define you. Let your love for Jesus be the thing that defines you. Look again at verses 16 and 17. If we're going to live out our faith in a way that creates a good reputation, it must be based on something good. Again, this is what Paul bases his entire rest of his letter to the Romans on. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is God's power for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For the righteousness of God is revealed in the gospel from faith to faith, just as it is written, the righteous by faith will live. So ask yourself this question tonight. What would look different tomorrow if I got serious about what we were talking about tonight? What would look different tomorrow if I got serious about what we're talking about tonight? If you embodied the thought that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus, how will tomorrow at school be different? What would look different in your life if you woke up and said, I'm going to let the gospel of Jesus pour out of my life into those around me by loving them? How might your second hour class be different tomorrow if you didn't put on a facade or a show or a mask, but you were real? What might happen if we didn't compartmentalize our lives so that we have like our Jesus and our church life over here, and then we have our non-Jesus life over here, but instead we make Jesus our entire life? How might we be different if this is a choice we made? We need to be about what we're called out to live out. We are called to live out the truth of the gospel every day. We are called to be grace-filled apostles of Jesus sent to share his love. So the question is, when you wake up in the morning, are you going to live out your purpose, or are you going to disguise yourself as something else? Tomorrow morning when you wake up, are you going to live the purpose of being an apostle of Jesus Christ sent into your classroom? Or will you be something else? Let's pray tonight. Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity we've had to look at your word. I thank you that you have purpose for us. You have meaning for our lives that goes way beyond what we think it is. Jesus, I thank you that you have purpose for our lives that was set at the foundation of the world. I pray that by your Holy Spirit, we would begin to see the purpose that you've called us to. That we would begin to live out this truth. That we would be about what we're called out to live out. We're called to love God, to love people, and to share the good news of Jesus whenever we have the opportunity. Help us, Lord, tonight. Speak to our hearts. Help us to honestly answer the questions that we've posed. In Jesus' name, amen.